Welcome to Afternoon Express South Africa. I'm Bonnie Mbuli. It's great to be back. And as you know, on Afternoon Express, we love to celebrate young people who are doing amazing things. And today is no exception. We're joined by a young author who's working on her fourth book. She's only 7 years old, and her name is Michelle Gamageng, and she is a recent recipient of a Mbogodo Award. And then we're joined by a sailing crew from Heart Bay who embarking on a tour of Cape to Cairo in 2017. And in the kitchen, Clem and Danilo up to something sweet.
I was about to say, you've been away from the loft for just enough time to forget my name, Bonnie. Welcome to the show, South Africa. It's so great to be with you. Hope your weekend was so relaxing and restful. Today on the show, not only do I have incredible guests, we've also got a chance for you to win big with us in the Clicks Advent Calendar giveaway. There's a Chevy Spark to be won towards the end of the competition. But for today, however, when you see the big Christmas tree pop up on screen, give us a call immediately and you can win yourself a spot prize on the show today. That enters you into the draw to win yourself that car at the end of the competition. So make sure you stay tuned right from now until 6 o'clock to make sure you do not miss that little symbol popping up on screen. Now, we do know it's the Christmas season. Everyone's in that festive cheer. Everyone's on that holiday mode. And what would Christmas be without a typical trifle? But today is not typical. Clem is trying to take a healthy spin on a trifle. I don't even know how that's possible. Challenge accepted. I'm stepping out of the kitchen. Bonnie's going to come and do this cooking with you because I do not believe it to be possible.
It's fine, Dan. It's okay. You know, the proof's in the pudding, and it's going to be so delicious.
Good one. Missed you over this week. Really cool jokes over there. So how do you take a healthy spin on something like a trifle?
It's kind of substituting a few elements of a trifle with something that's a little healthier. So sugar, try using honey, a natural sweetener. And especially this week, we're going to be focusing on a lot of sweet dishes. So it's kind of great to start the week off with something a little on the lighter side.
I love that, and especially with everyone's New Year's resolution starting to become more sort of health focused, I'm pretty sure you guys are also going to want to make sure that you try this over the festive season to get yourself prepped on how you can still have dessert and look after your body at the same time. This is Afternoon Express. We're so excited to have you with us this afternoon. Bonnie's on the couch with our first guest.
Now, I should know, the school holidays are in full swing, and while most kids are splashing around in the pool and building sandcastles and just generally being naughty, 1 7-year-old from Joburg is plotting her next novel. Michelle Gamageng is Africa's youngest author and started writing her first book at the age of 5 and is currently working on her fourth. She joins us this afternoon along with her biggest support, her mother, Lolo. Welcome to the loft, ladies.
Thanks for having us here.
Lovely to have you with us. So congratulations, you just won an award.
Nah.
Didn't you?
Yes.
An Mbogodo Award. How did it feel when they announced your name to come receive an award?
I felt happy, excited, and proud.
And proud. And what did you say? Did you give a speech?
Yes.
What did you say?
I said that I am very pleased to receive this award and that I receive it on behalf of children, including girls of South Africa.
Mm-hmm. Well, congratulations on your published book, Waiting for the Waves. You're working on a fourth novel as well, right?
Yes.
Well, you're just absolutely extraordinary. But please tell me how you came up with the idea to write this book, Waiting for the Waves.
When I went to a special place for a vacation with my family, and I saw the waves, and then when the second wave was still coming, I was in there with my father. So then when the second wave was still coming, I asked my father, why are the people looking that side? So then he said, oh, because they're waiting for the wave to come because the direction is that way.
And then you thought, I'm gonna write a book.
Yes.
How many people your age think like that? Come on, tell me. How many people do you think see a wave and they think, I'm going to write a book about that wave?
No.
No. So what makes you think like that?
What makes me think like that?
Yeah. Because it's a very special thing to think when you see a wave. Okay. So when she told you she was writing a book, you found out from her that she was writing a book?
No.
How did
she
you
wrote
find
it
out
through a right? secret. She only came and gave me the book after she had finished writing.
And she said, Mom, I've written a book.
Yeah, then I was like, what are you talking about? Because she created her own book, the A4 paper, then...
When drawings, I was, everything.
No, she didn't actually draw. She was... Yeah, so she was writing the whole place. Then I was like, what are you talking about? Then she said, Mommy, I finished writing my first book. I said, book? So I was like, were you writing? She said, yes, it was a secret. So But I didn't take it seriously from the first start, so I just called the dad and was like, oh, guess what? He say what? I say, your daughter have just written a book. He say, a book? I say, yes. He say, are you no kitty? So I was like, okay. Then also meet, I was like, no. Then I took the book now and I keep it in the shelf. After 3 weeks, she came with another one. Then I was like, ah, why are you disturbing me?
What's going on with these books?
So I didn't take it like it was a talent or a gifted stuff. Then after 2 months, she came with another one. That is the time we're like, oh. Actually, she said, Mommy, if people don't publish my book, I will stop writing. So I feel guilty. I was like, no, let me not kill her dream. So that is where I took it seriously. Then we take it from there up to
now.
Wow.
So. I want to find out from you what steps you took, because maybe there are many kids watching who are like, I've written a book and I gave it to my parents and nobody did anything about it. But how long did it take you to write this book?
It took me 1 month.
1 month. And then would you like write it after coming home and doing your homework? And
yes.
When would you write it?
I would write it when I have spare time.
When you have spare time. And how did you know it was perfect and finished?
Because I was busy checking my spelling.
Mm-hmm. And were you writing on a computer?
Mm-hmm.
Well, there's a picture of you writing on a laptop. So did you do a spell check on your computer? Girl. Now, okay, we have an excerpt here that I think you'd like to read for us to give our viewers a better idea of what your book is about. You can read it up to there.
The big wave. Uncle Joe, the big wave. See over there, she says, pointing at the ocean. Is it coming our way, Uncle Joe? Titi looks at him frightened. Because she is too scared, she moves backward, turns around and runs back to Uncle Joe.
Isn't she absolutely a delight?
It is.
So what did you do when you decided, okay, I have to do something about these books? What was your first step? Did you contact a publisher? What did you say to them? And did you believe that the books were worth publishing?
No, at first I didn't, because unfortunately I'm not a writer. I'm a businesswoman and an entrepreneur. So, but I gave it to one lady who is an author. So I said, please, can you look at me this manuscript and tell me? She said, no. It's good, it's a worth book because it's from a child. Because remember, there are author who wrote a children book. But this one is different because it's a child from a child. So they know what they want and all those kinds. So then I was like, okay, can we publish it? So I was thinking when they say publisher, it's one person. So but the lady said, no, we need to look for 1, 2, 3. We need to look for
illustrator,
printer, editor. Then I was like, oh. I own a company because I'm a CEO of Lansing Event. So I said, but why can't I use it like part of my services? So I myself, I didn't know anything, but I took the challenge, went to the internet, do research on how to publish a book, then started looking for a team that will come out with the book. So it took me 2 months at least to come to put everything together until you can have the hard copy now. So, but it was a big challenge and I took up to the challenge, and also it was a learning process. I'm happy.
Oh, that's incredible. Mm-hmm. I'm so glad you just had the courage to believe in your dreams. Now, what did your friends and your family and your teachers say when they found out you were writing a book? And you'd written a book?
My friends, they were really proud of me. Mm-hmm. And they said, oh, Michelle, you've written a book. Please tell me how to write a book.
And so did you tell them?
Yes.
So if you were to teach me how to write a book, what would you advise me to do? What should I do first?
One is always follow your dreams. Two is never let anybody get in your way. Three is if you can't read, you can't write.
What is going on here right now? Oh my gosh, that is incredible. So how many books have you read?
It's uncomfortable.
It's uncomfortable, the amount of books that you've read. You can't tell me the amount of books that you've read because it's uncomfortable. You are hilarious. Okay, so now that you've written 4 books, what do you want to do when you grow up? Because clearly you've just aced being a writer.
I want to keep on writing to keep my score going up.
Mm-hmm.
And I also want to be a pediatrician.
And you also want to be a pediatrician. I mean, that makes sense. Obviously, if you've written this many books at this age, you want to be a pediatrician. Any parents who are watching out there and asking themselves, and even myself, I have two young boys, how do I encourage my children to follow their dreams? How do I support them, and how do I steer them in a direction that makes them feel like they can contribute something so meaningful to society?
The advice I can give to them is like, we should just say, you should do it like fun. You shouldn't take it seriously because they are still kids. So just support them, but because what I see parents do wrong is when they see that their child got a talent and so they force their child or they put the pressure on that child. So just leave a child to be. You should just continue like a child, do what they do, but on the other hand, they are doing it like a fun, because when they do it like a fun, you will see they will go a long way without even you noticing.
Well, that is such an incredible story, and I can't wait to read more of your writings. I'm going to make sure that I follow you. I'm actually going to buy your books for my sons, and I'm going to tell them about this one seven-year-old who's written a book.
Yeah, they can catch
it. They should be writing a book.
Yeah, it's on Instagram, on CreateSpace, Amazon. Uh-huh. Then, and also, his e-book is on Amazon. By early next year, they will have it in all the bookshops in South Africa, across South Africa.
Wow, thank you so much, ladies, for joining us today, and congratulations again.
Thank you.
Thanks for having us, Buna.
So today we're giving away copies of Michelle's book, Waiting for the Waves. So pick up your phone and SMS the keyword books, your name and city to 33650. SMSs are R1.50 each. T's and C's apply and can be found on afternoonexpress.co.za. Let's go over to Danilo and see what you have to say on social media. Welcome back to Afternoon Express on SABC 3. Hello, Clem. How are you? It's so lovely to see you again.
You too.
And we're about to make a very berry trifle.
With a bit of a healthy spin. Because we know that this festive season, we're all going to be enjoying everything sweet. Yeah. And like, you know, we're going to go a bit crazy. It's going to be the season of regret. Because at the end of New Year's, everybody's like, yeah.
Did I eat all of that?
And if I could take it back, I would, but lies, you would still do it again.
So
we're going to kind of prepare you. So this time when you're doing the festivities, kind of just be conscious about the way that you're preparing your food, and it'll make such a huge difference.
And trifles are like the go-to dessert for South Africans. South Africans of all races, of all ages.
I think so, but I mean, the fact is, the truth, we were talking about this earlier, trifles are basically like, there's no guideline to what you put into a trifle. It's whatever you feel like.
You just put on.
Exactly.
And on and on.
So today we're going to kind of show you how to create those layers that we put into a trifle by using some different ingredients.
All right.
So in our machine already, I've got something that you can't, like, I'm not going to substitute. The original butter and sugar. But I just reduced the amount of sugar in there, and I kind of beat it up to this nice fluff and thick, as we've done like right here. The next part is, this is for our sponge that we're going to make. Because I mean, every trifle does need a bit of a sponge.
Yeah.
So also, machine just goes
on. But when you're lazy, you just put like crushed tennis biscuits down there, innit?
Exactly.
Am I wrong?
You're right. So this is a really easy sponge recipe.
Okay.
All the ingredients are of the same weight. So that's kind of like, as long as you have equal weights, you're gonna make different batches. So if you want a little more, just increase the weight to maybe like 100 grams of everything, it'll be totally fine.
Okay.
So get the eggs in there, nice and fluffy, and then a little bit of whole wheat meal flour. Okay, which is great because it
has... going a bit healthy,
health-conscious this season? Yeah, and also, it doesn't change the recipe too much. It doesn't make it more dense. So you're going to get the same result, but it's a healthier wheat. It's got more fiber in it, which is really great.
It just makes that layer of fat around your stomach a bit thinner. Is that what you're saying?
Exactly. So this is one of the recipes that I learned when I visited the Woolworths Discovery Healthy Food Studio. Uh-huh. And it was really, like, interesting going there because... One of the biggest things... Oh, flour everywhere. One of the biggest things that I learned was that you don't have to substitute flavour when it comes to being... healthy or health conscious. There are certain ingredients that you can use. You can get the same result just switching out ingredients. So super easy, and that's all you need. Let me just open it up for you, and I want to show you what the batter actually looks like. I don't think I need to pour it in. So this is what the batter looks like, a nice fluffy batter.
Yeah.
What we do is we layer that.
It looks so chiffon-y.
That's the thing about chiffon cakes. They're very airy, and that's what you kind of want. So all you do is you pour that into your tray, and your tray goes to the oven. I am looking for trouble. You put it over here. So it goes into the oven, and literally like 20 minutes later, this guy comes out, beautifully aerated. And all you do is you take a glass and you just squeeze down.
Okay.
Preferably the glass that you're going to use to layer the trifle. If you're going to use a bigger one, that's fine. Just actually cut into bigger pieces to layer in your big tin. Mm-hmm. But we're going to do individual ones. So I'm using the actual glass that we're going to layer in to cut out the rounds.
Okay.
And you can see what whipping the cream, the eggs and the sugar, which is called the creaming stage, does. Beautifully aerated, beautiful layers, nice and soft.
Mm-hmm.
Super easy. they would have done is, we've spoken so much about the fact that our berries in South Africa are like very sweet and bursting of flavor. It is, and the sun kiss is what makes the difference. So I've got a whole variety from Woolworths. They've got the blackberries, I've got raspberries and strawberries. And all I've done is I've added them to a pot, no sugar added, because they are really sweet enough.
Yeah.
And all I've done is I've blitzed it up and I've made this beautiful berry coulis, which we're gonna use as, you know, you always have to dunk the kind of the sponge in something. Normally use like a jelly solution or a sweet syrup. This is gonna be our new dunking solution. So our beautiful sponges get dunked into our berry coulis, as well as we're gonna use a layer of the berries when we're layering. Okay. Now, so we've got our sponge done. We've got our sweet, fruity element done, because you've got to have fruits in there. You must.
Absolutely.
And now we talk about the custard. Now, we're so used to traditional yellow custard, which nothing wrong with that. But we're going to kind of go a little healthy and use yogurt. Yogurt has a unique flavor, which lends so well when you're using fresh ingredients like berries. So it's got a sweet tartness in there. So to counteract that, we can use a little bit of honey. And it's got, you get that wild flavor from honey. You know you're eating honey. It's not some other sweetener that's in there. And that is amazing. That's why honey just is such a great sweetener, and it's a natural sweetener.
Right.
So in my pot, I've got some yogurt already, and I'm going to add a little bit of the honey.
It's just room temperature yogurt.
Yeah, because all we're going to do is, well, it can come out the fridge, it's totally fine. We're going to pop it into a pot, and we're just going to warm it through. Again, we don't want to boil it, because you don't want to destroy too much of the texture of the yogurt that you've got ready, because you want that natural texture in there. It's just going to take the heat out a little bit. And in here, actually, it's gone. It's disappeared. It's in the bowl over here. You can't see anything, so let me just shift it over here.
Is that gelatin?
There's something in there.
There's something in there.
So I've taken my gelatin.
Is it an amoeba?
I've taken my gelatin and I've added it to some cold water. Always cold water, never warm water. And that way it properly activates. So you're going to let it sit in there until it looks like a bit of an amoeba, a bit of a jellyfish.
Yeah.
Get some of that excess water out.
And you put it in the yogurt.
And it's kind of going to set like a, almost like a yogurt panna cotta. Which is quite, it's two desserts in one. So all you're going to do is make sure you get that amoeba. As it warms, your gelatin is going to melt through your yogurt. And once it's disappeared into your yogurt, you know it's done. So it's kind of great because you get that beautiful jelly-like panna cotta texture in your yogurt. And with that honey, it's really, really tasty. So I've focused on these three elements, your sponge and your berry coulis, and our, I call it a yogurt panna cotta to layer our trifle. And those are basically all you need to make an awesome, healthy, conscious, very berry trifle. And you can see there, our gelatini is mixed through beautifully. So yeah, three elements done.
Okay.
When we come back, we're gonna assemble, gloves on. It's gonna get a bit messy. You can't get anything on that, so
no,
I'll do it
no,
all.
I'll watch you let it get messy, but it promises to be really exciting. And our keyword is health. SMS that keyword to 33650. SMSs cost R1.50. No free SMSs apply, and you'll get a link to the recipe and the list of ingredients. Let's head over to Dan with our next guest.
Oh my word, those trifles look so amazing. I know everyone, every auntie, every uncle, every granny has got their own variation. I cannot wait to see what you guys make from this health trifle. It sounds super, super delicious. Now, ladies and gentlemen, the new year is approaching us very fast. And on the 1st of January, 7 Capetonians from the Griffin Sailing Team in Hout Bay will embark on a sailing journey halfway around the world in the Cape to Rio Ocean Race, the longest continent-to-continent race in the Southern Hemisphere. We're joined today by two of the senior team members, Marco Tobin and Theo Jan. Welcome to Loft.
Thanks
so
for having
Theo,
us.
So, Theo, you're captaining the ship, right? You're the, what do you call your name?
Skipper.
Skipper. And I see you wearing a skipper because you're wearing your boat shoes. I see, is that like a thing?
Yeah.
When you wear boat shoes, you know you're the boss on these sort of boats, right?
Yeah, I get to tell the guys what to do and make decisions.
Theo loves that. I'm telling you, off air, he was having so much fun telling everyone else what to do about this boat. So let's talk more about yachting and your love for ocean and the ocean adventure. Where did your love for fishing begin and for the oceans?
Like, grew up in Hout Bay, so I was like right at the sea. So it started about 16 years ago. I was about 12 years old when I started sailing. So from there, I just loved the sport. And then I just went on like level steps, like getting up and going, like international racing, local racing. So it's just growing. And then Cape to Rio was just one big thing that we want to do as some friends. Because we all doing it together as friends, yeah, like Marco, Daniel, Andre, Julius, Clarence, and then Lorenzo. So we've got a bit of a good team going, and It's going well.
So you've done the Cape to Rio once before, so I want to catch up with you in just a bit about that whole experience and what the Rio is like, because I know it's an epic race. I always used to watch it as a kid. Whenever my uncle used to take out his little dinghy boat, we'd just go and see the boats go off. But exactly what exactly is sailing versus yachting versus, yeah, what is the difference? Explain this to me, because I'm a real beginner here.
I think the biggest difference is the fact that sailing is wind-powered, so we'll have different levels of sailing at the dinghy level, where Theo and I started, and that's sailing on the small dinghies and two-man or one-man boats. And I think that's where the love began, you know? I think we're just doing it at the higher stage, where it's now, instead of a two-meter-long boat, it's now a 40-foot yacht that we... that we're taking not just in a pond but across an ocean. So I think it feels like it's us just going down to the dam and doing a race, but we're just doing it in the bigger dam, you know, it's called the Atlantic Ocean. Yeah.
So let's start with the extreme. What's the worst that could go wrong?
The boat can go aground or the mast can come down. That's why we, at the moment, the boat's in pieces. We're making sure that we're servicing everything, that nothing will go wrong. But those things you can't really say, like, when it's going to happen or anything like that. Mm. So it could be all of a sudden then something goes wrong. Mm.
So yeah. You've done it before, obviously, so you maybe have experienced what life like is like out on that ocean, especially when you're trying to race, not only just survive. Talk us through what a day is like out there and how grueling is this race?
It's, like, really sometimes, like, the first few days out of Cape Town, it could be, like, it's normally, like, windy and, like, you have, like, big winds. And then you wait till you get to the trades, like, 5-6 days out, get nice sunny weather, like very hot.
This sounds like a jaw and like a party more than it sounds like a race. So is it hard work? Do you guys all have to be on deck all the same time, Marco? Like, because I know obviously being a member on this team, you have to do stuff, I'd assume, because if it's wind powered, what happens then? It looks like you guys are just out on the open ocean, but how do you make sure that you win? Like, what is the challenge here?
I think there's different stages to the race, really. As Theo mentioned, that coming out of leaving Cape Town, that the conditions are quite rough. And last year, the last Rio race, there was actually a fatality. And it was due to the extremeness of the weather. And but the full race, you deal with different challenges as you progress. Mm-hmm. And to ensure that everybody is fresh when they are racing the boat, is that we work on a shift system. So if the weather does become extreme, it will require all hands on deck and people to do certain maneuvers or to make sure everybody's safe. We'll rather have everybody on deck. But as the race progresses, we ensure that we have a shift system where there's two people on the deck and on for 4 hours, on for 2 hours, and then off for 4 hours. And we'll rotate to ensure that everybody gets an opportunity.
So when you're off for 4 hours, where do you go? Like, are there toilets? Is there like a bed, or do you just almost sleep on the decks?
No, I think when you're not on shift, then you would actually do other work besides sailing the boat. So when you're on shift, you're steering the boat and adjusting the sails according and sailing a certain course. But when you're off deck, sails get broken. You need to do repairs to the boat. You need to ensure everything else is working. And in that, you just need to fit in time to rest.
And Theo, like, how long do you guys spend out at sea? Like, how long is this race, generally speaking?
We're speaking about 16 to 17 days. That's what we're planning to do.
Wow. Okay.
If the conditions is right.
Sheesh.
So, yeah.
It's a long race. And food-wise and all that stuff, I'm guessing all your stock has to be on the boat at all times. Yeah. There's no other, like, boat that comes and, like, rescues stuff to you and hands over stuff to you. It's a solo race, right? Once you're on that boat, that's all that you've got. So what do you guys do for food, and how does that work?
Like, food-wise, like, we'll make a list of what things we need. Like, the race, like, if you want to go racing, you want to pack as light as possible. So, like, the dry freeze food would be, like, ideal for the race. And then, yeah, so you try and cut off on the weight side, so you don't want, like, a lot of weight on the boat, because you're carrying that weight across the ocean, so the heavier your boat is, the slower you'll go. So
it sounded like you guys were, like, talking earlier on about how chill this weather comes out. Is there ever a point where you can just somewhere whip out your fishing rod and just go and catch some deep water fish, deep sea fish?
No fishing allowed.
Oh, really?
The captain has spoken.
Working. And how does one prepare for something like this, Mark? I mean, this is your first race. I guess you are still going into the unknown in some ways. How does one go about preparing for something as epic as the Cape to Rio?
We've taken part in a few other events, and there's been a few overnight sailing. And I think everybody knows how to sail the boat, but it's really once it's dark, you really don't know what's happening. We took part in the Mossel Bay race. It was from Falls Bay to Mossel Bay. And I think it went quite well. We learned a lot. and we stick to our guns and we managed to get a third overall. And
amazing. Well,
for a team that we started at the beginning of the year, yeah. And to really show our guns and to show we are competitive has been great.
Great. So we've got a chance to take home the Cape Torino this year.
That's why we're there.
Amazing. Good stuff, yeah, guys. Well, I know you guys are also involved with a really cool initiative happening in Hout Bay, and I think we've just touched the surface of what your careers are like, but where you guys got started and Theo, what you set up and are running now with the underprivileged communities, I'm really excited to unpack. So all that and more coming up next with these guys.
Really cool and exciting conversation happening in the loft today from an inspiring young lady who's an author at only 7 years old and all these incredible sailing adventures. Thank you so much for all the comments that you've sent us. And you're all as inspired by Michelle as we are. And some of you have said, Pimelo Mualosi has said, wow, I'm so proud of you, Michelle. Keep up the good work. Nurture that talent. Hashtag writing is a skill, indeed. And Khupulang Gopli Sondake says, wow, Michelle, I like the third advice. If you can't read, you can't write. I like it. And Yonela Noninjokweni says, wow, she's so young and yet so talented. Such an inspiration. A true inspiration. Another inspiring thing that's been happening on Afternoon Express this month is the Clicks Advent Calendar. We still have many more mystery prizes for you to win. So please look out for that Clicks Advent graphic at the bottom of your screen. And as soon as you see it, make sure that you call us if you want to stand a chance to win one of these mystery prizes and qualify for the grand prize at the end. More sailing talk when we return. Don't go away.
Welcome back to Afternoon Express as we celebrate young people doing amazing things with their lives. Now, before the break, we chatted to Marco and Theo, who are going to embark on a race across the Atlantic Ocean from Cape Town all the way to Rio at the beginning of January. We're back on the couch now with them, and we're joined by Daniel Agalis, who is one of the students at their development program called the Hout Bay Youth Sailing Development Trust. And he's part of this program, which is really cool. And you set this up, Theo. So tell us more about this trust and how this whole thing got started and why try and develop this youth? Because I would have imagined sailing was like a, you know, only the hoity-toity people did.
Yeah, no, the reason why we started the trust is we needed to get like boats on, like get the guys, some of our youngsters on the next level of sailing. But we never had like the equipment and stuff to get this whole thing off and going. And then through the help of LTC, we started getting this ball rolling about 3 years ago. So at the moment we've grown stronger and we've now got into this where we bought this boat and the plan is to do the Cape Torino race.
Lovely.
Which we're doing it.
And so Dan, you're obviously joining on to the team. This is your first Cape Torino, as I guess it would be for a lot of the team members that are on this thing. But your love for sailing, was it something that was there before and just couldn't get involved, or were you approached by the trust to say like, hey, how about exploring this thing? Or were you doing naughty things and they were like, no, come in here and focus your energy here? What was your story?
So I actually was doing naughty things first. I actually heard about sailing in general just through school, started in Grassy Park through an organization at Zikuflay Sailing Center, and Hout Bay Sailing gave me the break to kill boats. Before 5 years, just sailing dinghies, nothing else, traveling around only South Africa, and through the Hout Bay Trust, getting onto kill boats, I actually got to sail around the world.
So what is a kill boat? You're gonna have to start to go way back there. You sound like you're that guy. So what is a kill boat?
So a kill boat is one of the yachts that really can't be transported on trailers all the time. So dinghies get transported around on the road, and kill boats, if you transport it, generally you have to sail it from one place to another place.
Okay.
So that's what a kill boat is. So yeah, so started in Hout Bay, gave me my first break on a kill boat. From there, went to Mozambique, sailed from the Seychelles all the way to Cape Town, and it's through the trust that I actually got my first break into keelboats.
Sure. So when you say make your break into it, you're talking as though it's like a career thing, it's something that you do full-time. Is sailing a full-time thing for you? Is it a passion for you? Are the rest of the team making and taking an income from something like this?
So I'm lucky that I did get a break in sailing. I managed the sailing center, so I'm a student that moved on to manage the sailing center in Zikuflay. So I did get a break in it. I did also get lots of other breaks before this. When I finished school, I went to work in the roping industry, which links to sailing. And from here, I'm going on to boat building. So sailing is something you can make a career out of it.
Theo, you're sounding like you're nodding ferociously. You're very excited about that. Because, I mean, this must really make you proud.
That's really proud. I'm very proud of the guys of what they're achieving at the moment. Like some of our guys at the moment are busy sailing the Youth National Championships. So That's why I think Lorenzo won't be here tonight to join us. Mm-hmm. But I think we're doing, our program has taken off quite well. So I think, I don't know.
Yeah, I mean, just you must be so proud of the fact that these guys are just interested in coming to join something that you're so passionate about. I know, Marco, have you managed to see what's going on in this sort of initiative and what is going on in the communities and how is this a way for us to go and solve a lot of the ills that we're facing? I mean, are these community members biting? Are they enjoying the process?
I think, and it starts at the school level, and that's where all of us started around about 13, 14 years old. And it takes kids out of the community and opens them up to a world that they've never seen before. And I know Daniel and I, we come from the Zikuflay side, and the program that we run at Zikuflay is a Monday to Friday, and each school from the Cape Flats or from a previously disadvantaged environment, they get to experience sailing for the first time. Some of them, we had to teach them how to swim. So there's a lot of different avenues that you also explore, you know. So I think in addition to that, you also learn leadership skills, you learn to respect your peers. Sailing is a team, it's a team sport. So you can't be an individual or a Lionel Messi type of person. So you rely a lot on your crew, and working together in the team is quite important.
Yeah, I love that so much. And I mean, the team effort must be really cool. The bonding that happens on these ships while you guys are out in the open ocean must be something unheard of. And in terms of the entry point into something like this, I would have, like I said, imagined. I've been to the beaches in Cape Town and I've seen all of the beautiful yachts that are out there, and imagine it's just a rich guy's thing to do. But it seems to be something a lot of young people are also passionate about. How does one go about starting? Because not everyone can go buy a multi-million rand yacht to go and sail around the world.
Yeah, like with us at the moment is like we're like a bunch of friends, like we said, and we've all like chipped in to buy this boat because we don't have the amount of money to buy a brand new boat, so we bought the second hand boat. So like last year when we sold the cup, like our sponsors from the cup last year, so they decided that I think it's time to focus on something else and not just the cup. So they've decided that we need to get a boat to do the Cape to Rio race. And myself and Marco, we got handed that project to look for a boat. And we did it, and we've made a choice to get the Griffin, which was usually Gumption before we changed the name. Mm-hmm. But I think at the moment we've sold 3 events and we've got good results of it.
Also, you can just throw Daniel off the side if he gets too heavy and you don't speed yourself up. What are you most looking forward to when it comes to this race? Because, I mean, it's one of those big epic races. It's like, you know, people go and do the Comrades, they go and do the Argus, all those things. This is one of those things that I think is for the sailors, one of the biggest events in the world. What are you most excited for?
For sure, in Cape Town, Cape to Rio, or South Africa, Cape to Rio is the biggest event offshore. Yeah. And, like, going with friends is one of the main things, like, keeping friendships all the way for 17 days. All you have is like a 3-meter wide boat, 40 foot long. You can only walk forward and back, so keeping friends is like the main thing. And then, of course, ending up in Rio, the things you hear about Rio.
Those beach boys, I promise you're going to be too tired. He's going to be too tired when he gets there. You've done it once before. You know what's coming on the other side.
I know what's coming.
Keep this man in check. Keep him in check. Jens, I honestly wish you all the best for the race. We cannot wait to see you guys. I want to see you cross that line first. I really want to see you guys take home the prize, especially with the incredible project that you guys are working on. Keep developing our youth and giving them other platforms to divert all of their energies towards. So good luck to you guys. Let's take home the Cape to Rio 2017.
Thank you.
Over to you, Bonnie.
Good luck indeed, guys. It looks like you've put in a lot of hard work. And of course, do remember that whatever happens in Rio stays in Rio. You're all still very excited about our chat with young Michelle, our author. And Nompilo Majozi says, I love that smile. Keep it up, young lady. And Ofense Jeremiah Mokaya says, she's too beautiful inside and out. What a gem. And Simona Gebremichael says, wow, she's a beautiful little girl. Keep it up, smart girl. I'm sure she must be loving all your positive affirmations coming her way. And of course, our icon for our Clicks Advent calendar has come up on the screen. If you missed it, there is an opportunity again to call in tomorrow. But if you did catch it and you're calling us, stay tuned, because after the break, we'll be taking your calls and more cooking in the kitchen. Don't go away.
A warm welcome back to Afternoon Express. Yes, the smile is all because you get to win with us on Afternoon Express with the Clicks Advent Calendar giveaways. Loads of prizes are available for you simply by calling into the show when you see that symbol pop up on screen. You guys have been phoning like crazy. Our phone lines have been going mad, and we're about to choose a somebody onto the floor. Let's welcome Tandeka. Welcome to Afternoon Express. How are you?
I'm fine, how are you?
I'm doing very well, thank you. How was your weekend, first of all?
It was great.
Great. I'm about to make it even better for you by choosing any one of these spot prizes. The numbers I've got left for you are number 4, 6, 8, 10, 11, 14, and 15. Which spot prize would you like to choose for today? Oh, wow. That's definitely not one of our numbers, Tandeka. We'll try to get her back on the line to find out more details about which spot prize she's going to choose. And then from there, everyone who's won a spot prize on the show, you guys can obviously enter in yourself. Well, by winning a spot prize, you get yourself entered in to win a Chevy Spark with us on Afternoon Express. We'll get Tandeka back on the line. Over to you, Bonnie.
Hopefully we get Tandeka back on the line. And now to beauty. We all know that a smile is the best makeup you can wear and that true beauty comes from within. But we also all know that a few beauty tricks can go a long way to making you look and feel your best. That's why we have beauty expert and lifestyle blogger Cynthia Gwebu joining us today to share her summer lip secrets with us. Ladies, pay attention. The beauty desk starts now.
Hi guys, my name is Cynthia and I'm a beauty blogger from CynthiaGwebu.com. Today I'm at the Woolies desk and we're talking about lips today. So what I really love doing when it comes to summertime is hydrating my lips. And I really love using oils for that. You can have lip balms, whatever, but I really love using oils. And what I love the most about this one particularly, this is the Woolworths Treat Evening Recovery Oil. I like to use this, it has like a really nifty dropper. And so I'll deposit some product, about one drop or two drops, onto my finger and just apply it to my lips. Now I'm just dabbing it in a little bit more just to let it absorb. And then we're gonna go with the second step, which is using a lip liner. And I'm using the Woolworths Beauty Lip Retractable Liner. And I love this shade. It's a very natural lip liner. And the purpose of this is that we don't want the liquid lipstick to bleed. We have prevented that firstly by using a hydrating oil. And then secondly, we are making sure that when we do apply the liquid lipstick, it won't go outside of the lines. So the final step is to go in with your liquid lipstick, and I'm using this one from Stila. It's a beautiful mauvey shade, and Stila is available in selected Woolies stores. And we'll start off in the center, and then sweep it across. And that's the summer lip trend, a dusty mauve shade for the season.
There you have it, simple and effective. I can't wait to find out more. Luckily for us, Cynthia will be joining us on the couch in the new year to talk all things beauty for 2017. Trust me, you'll want to tune in. We've got Tandeka back at the Advent Calendar. Danilo.
So Tandeka, what happened? Get too excited for your spot prize?
I had some connectivity issues.
Shame, man. No stress. That prize is still yours. And we were left in suspense wanting to know which number you were going to choose. So what number between 4, 6, 8, 10, 11, 14, and 15 are you going to choose?
Number 6.
Number 6. All right. Let's get number 6 going. I'm going to call Michelle in with me. Michelle is our author who got in studio. I've been watching her. She's awesome, right?
Yes.
Okay, let's pull this, Michelle. Go. Hard. Ah, oh, no, we didn't do it again. Again. Go. Oh, there we go. Well done. Now, there's something inside here. Thank you, Michelle. So, Tandeka, you win yourself as a spot prize in Afternoon Express today. A Clicks Cub Card, Club Card, Gift Card to the value of 3,000 Rand.
Wow, thank you so much.
Now, that's obviously the winning doesn't end there. You get entered into our grand prize draw to win yourself a Chevy Spark on Afternoon Express. How would a car change your life?
It would make traveling for me and my family very easy.
Oh, lovely.
Coming from school to work and vice versa.
Awesome. Well, congratulations on calling in and making it through to the phone lines. You're our official winner for today. South Africa, don't forget, you can still win with us tomorrow again when that little symbol pops up on screen. You could be a winner in the Clicks Advent Calendar giveaway. Loads more spot prizes to give away for you on the show, so make sure you stay tuned for that. After the break on the show, Clem gets making us that trifle in the kitchen. Don't go anywhere.
Welcome back to Afternoon Express. We're about to finish up that trifle we started earlier on, right? Mm-hmm. So what's our next step?
Okay, so I've poked out a few more holes, and I've got this glass over here that's going to kind of be the one that we're going to demo with. So let me just get some space right over here. So what I've done is I kind of created my first layer with that yogurt panna cotta.
Yeah.
And so it goes in the glass, and it goes through the fridge. Now, very important, people seem to think that if you try to set your jellies or your panna cottas,
in
the freezer, it's going to set faster. Don't do that this festive season.
No, don't do it, yeah.
Yeah, keep it straight.
Otherwise, doesn't it get those icy splinters on the top?
Yes, and besides that, it actually slows down the process of the gelatin actually creating that jelly effect.
Properly.
So let it take its time. If you want to kind of fasten the process, a great thing to do is to actually take your jelly or your panna cotta solution, put it in a bowl, and then rest the bowl
in cold water
or ice. And ice, keep on stirring it, and you'll see it'll actually start thickening up very, very quickly.
Yeah.
And then it'll probably just take another hour in the fridge, and then it's done. Yeah. So this festive season, don't be cheating and trying to pop things in the freezer. It's not going to work. And the last thing is, the in-laws are on the way. You were in charge of the trifle. It was your one job.
You had one job. For the in-laws.
And then the in-laws stand there.
It's never one job with the in-laws, though.
No comment.
Yeah. Should we move right along?
So I'm trying to help you here. Okay, so set your jellies in the fridge, okay? And then the great thing about a trifle also is festive season things get really, really stressful. Trifles actually are at their best when they sit for about 2 days before the time. So make it 2 days
in the fridge.
In the fridge. So all you do is you build up your trifle. Don't do your final garnish, obviously. Just cling it at the top and pop it in the fridge. 2 days later, when it's you're coming out there looking fresh as, you know, you just do the final garnishes and you're looking like a star.
Dude, ain't nobody got time to start cooking the trifle 2 days before.
Bonnie, you're gonna do it on Christmas Day. You're gonna do it on Christmas Day.
Yeah.
I'm coming to your house.
I'll go to Woolies and get a ready-made trifle.
Okay, but preparation. Do this 2 days before the time, so on Christmas Day, you're chilling.
Okay,
cool. Okay. So your panna cotta is set first, ready?
Right.
Next step we're going to do is we're going to take our beautiful sponges that we got. Mm-hmm. And this is where it gets a little messy. But, I mean, we're going to try.
We love messy.
I do.
Yeah.
So then we just dunk it in slightly.
Because you're usually doing it and I'm watching.
From a distance, yeah. Because if you get berry stains on that dress, I don't want to know.
Yeah.
So that's why Dan's not in the kitchen, because Dan's kind of scared of the mess. Hey, Dan. So there we go. So
okay.
You see, you kind of, a little bit of the mess is fine.
Yeah,
it's okay. Got a cloth here at the bottom.
Yeah.
Now what I could do is, okay, for the adults, for the kids, I don't know, for the adults, a little bit of sherry. Just add that signature crystal, the Christmas festive taste.
Right.
Just a little bit on top, and
just
let that sponge absorb a little bit of the cherry, and
so
it adds
quickly,
a bit of moisture there too.
Did you see that? Mm.
Yeah. And then you just spoon some more over the top.
Okay.
And I like the layered effect. And because we're using these like white, red colors, it's quite festive.
Yeah.
But obviously,
is.
Like I said, play around with it, use different berries, make it your own. And also, like, if you're not that keen on yogurt, go the traditional method and just make your own custard. Don't worry about it. Cool.
Okay.
Next thing, I've got some fresh berries.
Right.
So real simple. I'm gonna take some more berries, adding more flavor to it. And just start topping all the berries on top, raspberries. And what this does is, besides adding more berry flavor, it adds texture. Trifle's all about texture.
The different types of textures, right?
It is.
Yeah.
So that's done. Right now, we're going for more sherry, but never mind. It's okay. So dunk it in there again.
Right.
We'll try not to be so messy
easy,
this time.
Easy, easy. Ooh.
It's okay. There we go.
We can always clean it up later. Okay, cool.
And basically, your only job is to make sure you get this perfectly layered. And then your final part is topping it with another layer of that yogurt, and then you set it in the fridge again.
Okay.
So you've got panna cotta at the bottom and panna cotta at the top, and all that yummy goodness in between.
In between,
okay?
Look at
so
that.
Let's
so
bring
gorgeous.
That over.
All those shades of red. Nice.
What do you think? These
look
really
it.
Great. So let's create some space.
Yeah, it kind of cleaned up well.
It is.
I was worried about you there for a second.
But you know, we got some kitchen festive fairies in the kitchen that like clean up after me.
Like some reindeers.
People can't see what's happening up here. There's so much mess because of me. It's just everywhere. I'm just joking. It's very clean kitchen. So what we're gonna do now is we're gonna start decorating our trifle. Okay. So Bon, this is where you get absolutely creative. And if you're feeling like you don't want to do too much on the festive season,
yeah.
You put this down, you put all these out, and tell everybody decorate your own.
Your own.
Okay.
Okay, I think that's exactly what I'm gonna do.
So Bon, literally decorate your own.
I can go for it now.
But okay, it's literally about making it your own. And then that's a great way to like get your guests involved and less work for you on the day. Christmas is all really about being stress-free. It's about being sharing time with your family, with friends.
It is, right?
So don't like literally exhaust yourself in the kitchen this festive season.
Yeah, because I spend the rest of the year slaving in the kitchen. So
exactly.
Why do it at Christmas?
So yeah, get your guests involved. And yeah, a couple of nuts
that's
are
looking
really, great.
Really good. I really love these coconut bits.
They are so delicious. And besides, we're talking about the crunch and the texture. And the great thing is, again, this can all be done ahead of time. So you're chilling, looking like a star on Christmas Day.
Absolutely.
Which is very important. Cool.
Nice.
And cherries, because you gotta. Cherries make all the difference to a dessert. And then some mint. Do you wanna add some mint to it?
Absolutely.
Just to kind of give it that festive
garnish.
Go
I
for
love
it.
Our garnish. Oh, you're putting like a whole one, like the whole tree.
I'm not
tree.
Even being shy.
A
I'm
whole
adding
mint
the whole tree. So yeah, that's your very, very Christmas trifles. And we've got kind of substituted our custard and our sugar for different different ingredients, and it's gonna taste just as good, if not better.
Absolutely. Mm. And on that note, the keyword for this recipe is health. SMS the keyword to 33650. SMSs cost R1.50. No free SMSs apply, and you'll receive the link for the recipe and the list of ingredients. I think this is ready to be served for our
sure.
guests. Should we?
You got that? I'll grab my one that I made. It's a little messy.
There is one without sherry for our special guest.
It's the little one right on the end.
The
she's getting
one.
So excited.
This
she's
little
like,
one.
Yes.
Sherry.
Guys, okay, can I just say two things? One,
one
it looks
for you.
Very nice.
Yeah.
And two, it's pretty coolie that you guys made it healthy.
Did you say it's very nice?
Oh my goodness.
I said it's very nice and coolie,
really
both in one joke. I did indeed. It's a Monday. I'm full of energy and I'm allowed to say things like that. Guys, this looks absolutely amazing. So yum. Wow.
Thank you so much for joining us today. Apart from the fact that I'm going to save up some lobola for you because you are marrying one of my sons, you did mention earlier that you're writing a book about your visit to Cape Town.
Yes.
Can't wait to read it. Give me a
hug. Are we going to be in it?
Yes.
Great, I can't wait.
Can it be about me?
I think Clem is going to have like a whole business model after the show. He's going to have to speak to Michelle to make sure that when he does his cookbook or something, that you do all of the words for it. How about that?
I think so. Mm-hmm. I think so.
It's a selling point. Delicious food and the world's youngest author. How about that? Guys, thank you so much for joining us on the show. It was so, so good to have you with us, Michelle and Mama. Enjoy making your festive season. I hope that it's a blessed time for you and your families as you guys spend some time together.
Thank you.
Make something delicious.
You too.
And we've got a special guest in the loft tomorrow, a very inspiring young man, Proverb.
Yep, oh yes. This man is in everything. He's TV, he's rapper, but I actually want to ask him a question tomorrow about his genius, because the guy is like a TV presenter, or like, you know, Zhuzh and Schwab,
yeah.
But then he's like, yo, I'm a rapper and I want to know what's up. So which one is he? I don't know which one Proverb
is. And please don't embarrass us and try to rhyme or rap.
Oh, my goodness.
We'll have to wait and see. See you tomorrow, South Africa. Good night. Ooh, happy eating. Bye.
Bye.
Yummy.